Hello students, I hope you must be fine. Today we will discuss explain why question of central nervous system. The question is explain why rubbing the painful area often relieves the pain. This is a very common phenomena. You also have experienced this thing when something get injured. Suppose there is some blow or some cut on the body part. You just touch it and you feel some relaxation of pain. What is the reason behind it? The reason is gait control theory decreases the pain sensations. There are other examples also which can activate the analgesia by this gait control theory. You have heard about acupressure, that also works by gait control theory. The electrical nerve stimulation, that is TENS, trans-electric nerve stimulation, and counter irritants, some ointments you are bringing from the market, they are not analgesic by themselves. They stimulate the gait control theory, okay? So all these pain relieving mechanisms by touching that painful part or counter irritant or electrical nerve stimulant or acupuncture or acupressure, all are working by this gait control theory. What happens in the gait control theory? I have already told you that pain is carried mainly in the lateral spinothalamic tract, okay? Suppose this part of the body got injured. And these pain pathways are going to the spinal cord. And here it synapses with the second order neuron. I have also drawn this diagram in the referred pain of MI. Every neuron is coming for pain and it is synapsing with the second order neuron. There are two pain pathways. One is fast and one is slow. Fast pathway is having A delta fiber and slow pathway is having C fiber. Fast pathway are myelinated and slow pathway are non-myelinated, but they are small diameter fiber. The pain pathways, the neurons are having very small diameter, but they are very thin, okay, diameter is very less. Whereas the pathway for the touch, they are large diameter fiber, okay. So they are carrying the pain sensation, they are carrying the touch sensation. Suppose this is the injured part and the skin overlying this. When you touch this part, the large diameter fiber will come. Okay. And what it will do? It will inhibit this pain pathway presynaptically, either directly or with the interneuron, which is substantia gelatin also. Okay. This is the synapse and it inhibits the pain pathway presynaptically, either directly or by the mean of substantia gelatinosa. The substantia gelatinosa work here like a gate. So this is the gate control theory. When pain is coming, suppose gate is open, substantia gelatinosa is not doing anything, it is not inhibiting the pain pathway. So pain will come and the higher order neuron will take the pain pathway and we will perceive the pain. It will go to the cerebral cortex. But when we touch that part, last diameter fiber, that is touch fiber, okay, which are coming through the dorsal, going through the dorsal column. They come and they give one collateral over here. These are going through the dorsal column and they are going up. But one collateral, one branch is given to this part and it directly inhibits the pain pathway or indirectly by the substantia gelatinosa. It stimulates this substantia gelatinosa. And this substantia gelatinosa just close this gate. It close the gate. Gate is closed, so pain cannot go. So we will feel less pain. So behind this is the gate control theory. Next question is, explain why a blind person may have an increased auditory power. It is because of cortical plasticity. But before embarking upon cortical plasticity, we will first see the sensory homunculus in the brain. Do you know what is sensory homunculus? The sensory homunculus is presentation of the various parts of the body to the sensory cortex. Suppose this is the sensory cortex, this is a cut section, this is the medial part and this is the lateral part. Okay. What happens? The body is represented upside down. Suppose this is the superior part and this is the inferior. The superior most part is representing the leg. The impulses coming from the leg are represented here. I am not too good at making diagrams. Please do understand. Okay. And the knee, the toes, then ankle, then leg, then hip, then sacrum. This is just in the opposite manner. Lowermost part is getting represented at the uppermost part. Then comes the trunk, neck, upper limb, hands, and these are the fingers which are represented here coming down. Okay. And the part which are concerned with more finer aspect of the touch, they are having larger representation. You see, the leg is having more area, but it is having less representation in the sensory cortex. But the hands, which are fine detail, they are having more representation. The face, which is having more area. Okay, tongue more, larynx more area. The area of tongue and larynx is more than the total area occupied by the lower limb because they are having more touch receptors. So suppose this part is representing the eye, okay, and this part is representing the ear. Okay, now what's happen in a blind person? No visual input because it cannot see, so no visual processing. So this part is not having any sensory input. Now what happens? The area which is representing the ear, the neurons gradually shift from ear to ear and occupies large area. Normally, this representation is non-mutable. Which part is representing in the brain? It will work for that part only. But when one part, the impulse are not coming from that part, the other part's neuron will occupy it. So now, ear is having, the auditory cortex is more in area in comparison to previous one or in comparison to the normal individual. So they are having more auditory part. They can discriminate the sounds more in comparison to normal person because of greater representation in the brain. And this phenomena of the brain is known as cortical plasticity. When one part of neurons are not taking the sensation, the other part overcomes it. This phenomena also occurs in the amputated limb. That is phantom limb. I have already told you. When the phantom limb is not there, the limb is not there, other part which are representing the other parts of the body, they overlap that part. Okay. So this is all about the cortical plasticity. Next question is, explain why bed sore may occur in paraplegic patients in complete cord transection. This topic we have discussed one time before. Now we are taking the details. What happens in paraplegia? What is paraplegia? Paraplegia is paralysis of both the lower limbs. Okay. When the spinal cord get transected at some lower level, both the lower limb get immobilized or paralyzed. That condition is known as paraplegia. Along with paraplegia, there is complete sensory loss below that level and fall of VP due to loss of sympathetic vasoconstrictor tone. Now what happens? There are 3-4 phenomena which lead to the bed sore or decubitus ulcer. What is bed sore? Ulcer forms in the skin. There are wounds in the skin because of lying down or same position. Suppose the person is lying down in the one position because it cannot move, he is having paraplegia. Okay. Now what happens? There is already hypotension or loss of leading to loss of blood supply to this part. Suppose this is the sacral skin overlying the sacral area. Number one, loss of BP leading to less blood supply. Not loss, there is decreased BP. Okay. Leading to less blood supply to the part. Second thing, there is sensory loss. So no sensation will go of pain or compression or pressure. Okay. Third one is, the person keeps on lying in this position. In supine position, the pressure will transmit it to the skin overlying the sacrum area. Suppose, so what will happen? There would be more pressure, less blood supply, and there would be breaking down of the skin over the bony prominences. Over the bony prominences, blood supply is more hampered due to weight of the body. The whole weight of body is getting transmitted to that part. Okay. And when this happens, ulcer is there. And this ulcer is not healing. Why? Because the situation in which spot transaction is there, the person is in negative nitrogen balance. So because of negative nitrogen balance, this ulcer is not healing. So it lead to bad sore or decubitus ulcer. What are the reason? Number one, loss of blood supply because of decreased BP. Second is sensory loss. Third is pressure of the body, and it don't heal because of negative nitrogen balance. So what we can do to prevent this bad sore? The person should keep changing the position. One time he should lie in the left lateral position. One time he should lie in the right lateral position. One time he should sit with some support so that there would not be any proper continuous pressure on any one point. So bad sore will not develop. And the wound should be dry so it will recover. Because bowel and bladder habits are already lost, so it leads to moisture and continuous wetting of this area. So it worsens the bad sore. So the person cannot move. It should take help of some family member and keep on changing the position so bad sore will not develop. Thank you. If you like this video, please share and subscribe it. And if you have any problem, let me know in the comment section. Have a good time. Bye bye.